إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abundantly and we ask Him to exalt and mention and grant peace to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to all those who follow him on his righteous path until the day of recompense. Brothers and sisters in Islam, in times when those involved in da'wah look around them and find that the Muslims are either too busy chasing after the dunya to have any time for da'wah. This business transaction, that customer, that, you know, I don't know what, this house to purchase, this car to trade, something which prevents them from even involving themselves in da'wah. They're just bystanders, spectators, those who just watch others do it. And Allah gave them the means to be involved. They may have the language, they may have the knowledge, they may have the money, they may have the time, they may have the transportation, they may have something. But somehow, it's just that, you know, da'wah, as if da'wah is restricted in some individuals, they can't really deal with it. And so they don't do the job. They don't do the job. They're too busy with the dunya. That's one portion of the Muslims. Another one, which is also sad, it is those who lack the courage, who lack the bravery to convey the truth of Islam as it is, without twisting it, without sugarcoating it. For example, the pledge of mutual respect and cooperation. Have you heard about that one? Maybe you have not. Some brothers brought it to my attention. I checked it out. Then I checked out what the scholars had to say about it. And it is a very sad reality what some of the du'at in the West, the English-speaking du'at, have come up with as supposedly trying to bring the Muslims together. So, one of them, may Allah guide him and rectify his condition, who is a graduate from Medina University, I guess he's the one who authored it or has something, some major role to play in it. And the idea of this pledge of mutual respect and cooperation is that we and the people of Bid'ah just do everything without having to deal with each other, speak against each other, or, you know, anything which may conflict in each other's interests. Imagine Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, Al-Ta'if al-Mansura, Al-Firqa al-Najiyah, the ones that have been given the qualities and the descriptions to be saved, are going to agree and promise to leave alone the people of innovation? For what? For who? For what goal? To bring what back according to whose understanding? Wickedness. Wickedness or feeble-mindedness. There isn't a third option. How can someone be upon the way of the righteous predecessors and know that Imam Malik said, rahimahullah, that nothing will bring back the glory, nothing will return the ummah to the condition it was upon, except that which rectified that earlier generation? We will not be able to succeed when we mix with the people of deviance and innovation as if there's absolutely no differences between us. Because the truth will be lost in the mix, and if the truth is lost, how is Allah going to give us success? That whole idea is based on a false foundation. We don't deny that wisdom is expected in the way we deal with these issues, that we advise and we try to work things out and what have you, but there are limitations. There is a dead end after which you can't cross. Never, never were our righteous predecessors on the verge of you know, saying to the people of Bid'ah, no problem, you leave us alone, we leave you alone. You don't say anything about us, we don't say anything about you. You keep your Bid'ah, ma fi mushkila. And I will sign, you sign, you sign, you sign. Sufis, some of the biggest Sufis in the world, grave worshippers, you name it, or have signed this pledge. Supposedly, this pledge is based on, you know, mutual respect and cooperation. It is based on mutual deviance and misunderstanding. That's what it is. And this is the other form of set of dua. So either someone is too busy to give da'wah, or is given da'wah, but now ma'alesh, yani, you know, the people. Where's Allah? Where's Allah in the process? The people. What do you want from the people? The people are never going to be happy. If you're going to go chasing the people, I can make you happy. As soon as you're happy, he's not going to like it. Then I'll make him happy. As soon as he's happy, he's not going to like it. And I can go around this auditorium and wind up with only one person agreeing with me, because you can't make people happy. But you have to make Allah Azza wa Jal happy. And that doesn't happen by you saying, oh, I'll compromise your right, oh Allah, so that Fulan can be happy. So that the kuffar can say, oh, the Muslims in the West are a single body, they have no differences, you know, they're nice, a nice, you know, group of people. So what? You think that people are going to enter into Islam afwajan because they saw that you didn't warn against the Sufi? Come on, bro. Where are you living? Keep it real. What is preventing non-Muslims from Islam is either that Allah knows they're so bad, Allah is not going to guide them. They don't deserve guidance, or we Muslims don't have the bravery that the Sahaba did in conveying the truth. So we lie and we cheat and we claim things that are not part of Islam. And guess what? Not all of them are dumb. They can tell when we lie. They can tell when someone sits behind it and says, Islam is peace. Islam is about peace. There's no jihad. The only jihad is the jihad of the soul. You fight against your struggle, you know, your shaitan, khalas. That's where jihad ends. Every ayah you read in the book of Allah, you have misunderstood it. Ya Sheikh, haram alayk ya Sheikh. Why are you afraid to tell the people the truth? Don't you think Allah gave him a brain? Don't you think this kafir is going to open the Quran, read Surah Al-Anfal, and he's going to come across these ayat, the military ayat, which you've been trying to hide? Then what are you going to do? Then he's going to say, you guys were lying to me the whole time, and you keep telling me something, and here's your book, here's your Quran. Oh no, but no. See, you don't understand. This ayah, it was actually abrogated by the other ayah, لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينَ. So now they twist things around. That was in the beginning. I mean, عجيب يا أخي. So you keep playing with the deen of Allah and changing and altering and sugarcoating to please a bunch of people. And at the end of the day, the da'wah is lost in the process. Very sad. So they alter the truth. And they don't have the strength to say it as it is. وَاللَّهُ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah guides whosoever He wills. It's Allah's duty. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, which he took upon himself to guide those who want to be guided. And Allah did not place on us this responsibility of grabbing people by their necks and bringing them to Islam. You don't have to do so. You give them da'wah, and if they are deserving of guidance, trust me, Allah will guide them in ways which you will never perceive. And if you read the biographies of the Sahaba and the Tabi'in, this will become evident to you. Against all odds, people enter into Islam. When you think that the least of the da'wah, people enter into Islam. Those who enter into Islam the most today among the genders are women. Even though the women in Islam is portrayed as the worst. I mean, the males say, okay, you have to have a beard. Fine. You know, Harley Davidson driver, you know, riders also have a beard. I can manage that. But the Muslim woman, that means she has to cover her hair, and she has to change her dress code, and she has to do this, and she has to obey her husband, and she cannot do this, she cannot do that. That's a lot of restrictions. And women enter into Islam. Why? Because Allah guided them to Islam. And it wasn't your job to say, no need for the hijab, sister. It's okay. Allah will forgive you. On whose behalf are you speaking? People bring some outlandish fatwa, and they give concessions as they go along, as if Allah gave him the authority to do so. No, Habibi, you don't have the right to do so. You have to wear the hijab, but we say if your iman is not strong enough, don't let that prevent you from accepting Islam. Embrace Islam. As your faith grows, you on your own will put on the hijab. But don't say you don't have to put on the hijab, or that this is not important in Islam, or it's not an obligation. That's the other crazy fatwa. It's not in the Quran, it's not in the Sunnah. This bid'ah is bid'ah. You know, the whole idea of covering yourself has no basis. It was, you know, made by I don't know who so they can oppress women. Again, people changing the deen of Allah in order to please those whom they're inviting. We are not allowed to do that. So anyways, at times when you, the one who's involved in da'wah, looks around and he sees either these people are too busy or these people are just, I don't know what they're doing with the deen of Allah. You have to, you know, look for a place to find comfort. You have to fetch for a place where you can relax and feel at ease. Feel a sense of belonging, that someone is on the same page. And some people are, you know, whether they are alive or they came in the past, they strove for this deen as Allah wanted it to be. Not those who made any changes. And the truth is, you will find discomfort and support in a story of a man whose story Allah narrated in his book. Allah narrated his story in his book. It's an amazing story. This man was a da'ya. He was a propagator of Islam. He was a real one though. He wasn't one of these fake ones. He was a real one. He was not one who changed. He was not one who modified in order to please his audience and the people. Not one who feared the blaming of the blamers when it came to Allah's rights. Not one who denied the teachings of Islam in order to please the disbelievers. Yet, he was gentle while being firm. He was merciful while being tough. He was brave while being wise. He was what every da'iyah should strive to resemble after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who followed the same footsteps, because all the prophets had that manhaj in their da'wah. We should strive to imitate them, because the ummah, the Muslims, are in dire need of people of that caliber and the qualities, and those qualities. It is the believer of the people of Fir'aun. Have you heard of him before? Maybe you have not. If you have not, then that proves one thing. You have not read the book of Allah in a language which you understand. Or you have read the book of Allah in a language which you understand, but you have not remembered what was in there. Because if you read Surah Ghafir, ayat 28 to 45, you will find that all of these ayat are dedicated to the story of this man and the conversation he had with his people and everything pertaining to that. This is why we restate and re-emphasize the importance of reading the book of Allah in a language which we understand. And we have two options at the moment. Either you learn Arabic so that you're able to read it in Arabic and understand, that's wonderful, but may not be feasible for everyone, or you must read it in a language that you understand, whatever your native language preferably, because that is usually the strongest. But this is a must, so you will know what the Quran is about. It is not a book that you read in Ramadan and then you put back on the shelf afterwards. It is not. This is not this kind of book. It is a book of guidance. And it will guide those who understand it. وَلِيَذَّكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ So the people of intellect will be able to take reminders. If we don't understand what it's saying, we're not going to be reminded with anything. If you prayed Isha with us right now in the masjid behind the IMC, in the ayat which the Imam recites are hundreds of lessons which we can deduce and we can speak of. But if we were standing behind him without knowing what he's saying, we will not be affected by the book of Allah. Even though the ayat which he was reciting are quite strong, full of deep thoughts and guidance. The importance of learning the Quran. So now let us go on a journey exploring the affair of this believer. Let us reflect on the dialogue he had with Pharaoh and his people. And finally, let us deduce the benefits and the lessons from his affair in order to integrate them into the da'wah we're involved in today, so that we can produce, by Allah's leave, a generation of du'at. A generation of du'at who, after the scholars, can deliver this ummah to the long-awaited success it has been promised. And with Allah lies success. We make the effort, and Allah is the one who guides and facilitates. But it is important to integrate it into our system of da'wah today, because this is the successful way of giving da'wah. So let us go to ayah 28 of Surah Ghafir and see what happened there. وعليكم السلام. وقال رجل مؤمن من آل فرعون يكتم إيمانه أتقتلون رجلا أن يقول ربي الله وقد جاءكم بالبينات من ربكم. A man, Allah says, وقال رجل مؤمن, a believing man, من آل فرعون, from the family of فرعون. Now the scholars have differed about who this man was. Some of them say his name was Sham'an. Sham'an like Salman. And they say that he was a cousin of Fir'aun. Some of them say he was a Coptic Egyptian. And some of them say he was just from Bani Israel. And the scholars have differed about who he was, and that really doesn't affect the issue much, because we're interested in what he said and what was said to him more than his actual identity. Nevertheless, he said, now, وَقَالَ رَجُلٌ مُؤْمِنٌ مِّنْ آلِ فِرْعَوْنَ يَكْتُمُ إِيمَانَهُ, who was concealing his faith, because Fir'aun was persecuting the people during his time. And you couldn't really stand up in front of Fir'aun and say, I'm a believer. In fact, when the magicians did that, what did he say? قَالَ آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ قَبْلَ أَنْ آذَنَ لَكُمْ لَأُصَلِّبَنَّكُمْ فِي جُذُوعِ النَّخْلِ. You have believed in him before I gave you the permission to do so. Isn't it amazing, this Fir'aun? I'm a hajib, this guy. You can't believe until he gives you permission. If you want to like something, says, how do you like it? How did you like chocolate without asking me first? Le. I want to like chocolate, man. What business do you have with me? No, he says, you believe before I gave you the permission. Supposedly, excuse me, Mr. Pharaoh, can we believe in Musa? Oh, go ahead. What business does he have? Crazy man. And you will see how crazy he is as we deal with the story. Then I said, I will crucify you on the trunks of the palm tree. And I will cut your arms and your legs, you know, from opposite sides. And he made all these threats, because you couldn't really say in his presence that you were a believer. How could you say that there's a Rabb besides him? When he said to the people, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى, I am your Lord the Most High. That is Fir'aun. We have many of his likes today, believe it or not. So he was concealing his faith. أَتَقْتُلُونَ رَجُلًا أَنْ يَقُولَ رَبِّيَ اللَّهِ. Musa had said, Fir'aun said, ذَرُونِي أَقْتُلْ مُوسَى. He said to his people, leave me, allow me to kill Musa. The scholars say this man, who was from the family of Fir'aun, had been concealing his faith until Fir'aun explicitly and publicly said, I want to kill Musa. Allow me to kill Musa. He became jealous for the deed of Allah. Mind you, his life is at risk. But at that moment, that kitman, that concealment of faith, was no longer the case. He said, are you going to kill a man because he's saying Allah is my Lord? And the lesson we learn is, never be afraid of speaking of Islam and your religion and your faith in Allah. Is someone going to kill you, or harass you, or mock you because you're saying Allah is my Lord? And what? These false idols that the kuffar are worshipping are better? Jesus, which they've made in that statue of Jesus, which they've claimed to be a god, is better? Shiva and Vishnu and Brahman are better? Buddha is better? What are these created beings that they're worshipping? And so the kuffar make it seem, or the atheists, like you are abnormal for saying Allah is my Lord. And they're the ones who are intellectual for claiming that there's no God, or some statue is their God. So we have to have confidence. Are you going to kill a man because he says Allah is my Lord? وَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ And he has brought for you the proofs and the evidences from your Lord. Do you remember what Musa did? Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, his staff, his stick, would actually devour the fake snakes of the magicians. He would take his hand out and it would be bayda. It would illuminate without any disease. It wasn't a leper. It wasn't a leper disease. It was a miracle from Allah. He split the ocean, ya jama'ah. He split the ocean into 12 parts. Many of the people, you know, they watch the old Hollywood movies of Moses and they think it was two parts. That's according to them. According to the tafsir of the ulama, they were 12 tribes of Bani Israel. And the ocean was 12 parts. Each tribe had their own pathway. Special privilege. This was Musa, alayhi salatu wasalam. He brought the proofs from Allah. And Fir'aun knew that. وَإِنْ يَكُمْ كَاذِبًا فَعَلَيْهِ كَذِبُهُ If he's a liar, then upon him is his lie. Yani he will pay for the consequences of his lie. Meaning, why would you kill him? Let's say someone comes and says that, you know, I am a prophet of a God or whatever, you know, during their time. Now we have a whole other story in Islam. During their time, if this man is claiming to be a messenger, he's claiming to be something which he's not, if he's lying, the best thing to do is to leave him alone. Leave him alone. Don't kill him. What's the point of killing him? Why? وَإِنْ يَكُ صَادِقًا يُصِبُكُمْ بَعْضُ الَّذِي يَعِدُكُمْ But if he is truthful, some of that which he has promised you will afflict you. Some of the calamities which he promised you will befall you. Now, as an intellectual person, what do? You play it safe. Okay, Fulan is making a claim. If I leave him alone, I got nothing to lose. If I harm him, and he promised me, if I harm him, he will harm me back, then I don't do that. I leave him alone to protect myself from the potential harm. So he was using intellect in dawah. The lesson which we learn at the moment is what? Using intellect in dawah. He's trying to give him options. Weigh it out, guys. Think it over. If he's lying, khalas, it's his liar. Leave him alone. You still Fir'aun, everything is still the way it is. But if he's saying the truth, then will you be able to deal with the promises he's giving you? That Allah will destroy you in this life and in the hereafter. وَإِيَّكُ صَادِقًا يُصِبْكُمْ بَعْضُ الَّذِي يَعِدُكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي مَنْ هُوَ مُسْرِفٌ كَذَّابٌ Verily Allah does not guide one who is transgressing or the transgressor, the liar. What does that mean? The ulama say he's trying to tell them, look, if this man were this man to be a liar, had he been a liar or a transgressor, then that would become evident for you in his speech. Meaning he would contradict himself. But you can see from Moses that there's no contradiction. You find him firm in his statement and backing up his statement with facts. The one who's upon lies, the one who fabricates and transgresses, Allah does not grant him success. Can you think of someone? Can you think of someone who was a liar and a transgressor and Allah deprived him of success until he became exposed? Jimmy Swaggart. According to Ahmadi, that's Swaggart. Swaggart. Jimmy Swaggart. This foolish man who, you know, tried to make fun of the Muslims about, you know, polygyny. We have a couple of terms. I'm not going to go into the technicality. And he said supposedly that, you know, Christianity allows me to marry only one. So I chose the best one, you know, from the first choice, supposedly his wife. Then he further went on to lie some more. Then he authored some books supposedly about prostitution and the evil of prostitution and blah, 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 blah. And it wasn't long before they called him with a prostitute. We thought that you had chosen the best wife from the first try. And we thought that you were offering books about prostitution and the dangers. So they called him with a prostitute. With pictures. SubhanAllah, look at how Allah exposed him. That's not the funny part. That is the funny part actually. It gets funnier. Then he came on TV and cried, oh God, you know, blah, blah. Another lie. Another mushrif get that. And what happened? They caught him again. Ajib, ya Sheikh. How can you be caught twice with a prostitute? Unless you were crazy. Or Allah had decreed that because you lied, you were a transgressor, kadhab, Allah will not guide him. He says something and he does something else. So he wasn't granted success. This is a sign. You watch all of these clowns that debated with, whether it was Ahmadiyyat rahimahullah, may Allah pardon his shortcomings and his errors, or otherwise, all of these clowns who come on the stage, eventually they are caught in the act of something which exposes them. And he Soros the same thing. They caught him stealing money from, you know, from the organization he was supposedly collecting money for, da'wah to Christianity. He was taking the money and burning the papers, the evidence. They all get busted. Why? Because it's the way of Allah. If someone's going to lie against Allah, he will not go for long. Look at the affair of Musa. He's firm, consistent. Allah will not guide the one who, meaning look, he's guided by Allah. That's why you find firmness and consistency. Look at everybody else. Every day they say something different. Subhanallah al-Azim. Then he went on to say, Ya qawmi lakumul mulku al-yawma zahirin. O my people, yours is the kingdom today while you're dominant on earth. I mean, they were powerful. Wa fir'auna dhil awtad. These people had soldiers, they had the pyramids. Until today, they're considered like something amazing. In the field of architect, this is not something that any one of us can do. It's Allah gave them particular things. And they were given dominance on earth. And he was advising, today it is yours. And Allah gave you the dominance. Then look what he said. فَمَن يَنصُرُنَا مِن بَأْسِ اللَّهِ إِن جَاءَنَا. So then who will protect us from the calamity, from the punishment, from the torment of Allah if it befalls us? Now watch how he included himself in the speech. He spoke in the plural. مِن بَأْسِ اللَّهِ إِن جَاءَنَا مَنْ يَنْصُرُنَا. He didn't say مَنْ يَنْصُرُكُمْ. He included himself out of compassion towards them. Meaning we're all in this together. Who will protect us from the torment of Allah if it were to befall us? Again, he's using this now admonishment. Now he's admonishing them. Meaning be thankful to Allah. We as Muslims need to be thankful to Allah. Allah has given us many blessings. He's given us the Quran. And he's given us the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he's given us knowledge which has been preserved. He's given us all the things which no nation has. And what do we do in return? Where is the thankfulness to Allah and his deen? What is the service we are providing? Because if the punishment of Allah comes, no one will be able to take it away. No one can remove the torment of Allah. Then he said, now listen to this. Fir'aun, after now the man exposes iman. Fir'aun stood up and said, وَقَالَ فِرْعَوْنُ أَفْوَلْ. Hey, وَقَالَ فِرْعَوْنُ مَا أُرِيكُمْ إِلَّا مَا أَرَى وَمَا أَهْدِيكُمْ إِلَّا سَبِيلَ الرَّشَادِ. Unbelievable. He said to them, I do not show you except that which I see. In other words, what I feel is good for me, I feel is good for you. I'm only showing you, sharing with you what I believe is good. What is it that he believes is good? That Musa will change the religion of the people and Musa والسلام, will spread corruption upon earth. Fir'aun is claiming that Musa will spread corruption upon earth. Who does that remind you of? The Sufis and the Wahhabis. The Sufis, these funny bunch of people who continue to change the deen of Allah as they go along, have the nerve to point at those who follow the Tawheed and give us names like Wahhabis and warn against us and claim that we are destroying the Ummah. And supposedly, they are the doing the job of bringing it back. Upon the Sunnah of who? Sheikh Nazim and Mawlana Aramu who? What deen is this that you're upon? So this is the same mentality. The deviant people, they look at the guided people and they scare the people away from them. So Fir'aun said, Musa will mislead you from the path of Allah. You know, he is Allah according to him. He will mislead you from your path, for he will change your religion. Follow me. مَا أُرِيكُمْ إِلَّا مَا أَرَى. This is the best thing for you indeed. And the same thing is being done today against the da'wah of Tawheed. I read you don't read the comments I read on my YouTube channel. I'm the one who reads them. Look, wallah, you won't believe. Ya akhi, I could swear by Allah that it's not a Muslim. It's like a Christian playing games and going to all these Muslim websites and trying to cause fitna. Oh, well, you know, I thought you were saying something correct, but you're just a Wahhabi. Three dots. What? What is this crime here? What did I do? Ya akhi, did you hear me say Allah said, the message of Allah said, alayhi salatu wasalam, what do you want? I didn't say the word Wahhabi in the whole lecture. Where did you get this from? And what are the basis of rejecting this truth? It's nonsense, ya akhi. They come up with all these things to scare the people from Tawheed and from the people of Tawheed, so they give us all these names and titles. One time we are terrorists, the next time we are Albanis, then we have Ibn Taymis, then we are Wahhabis. What? We don't have all these. We're not attached to one individual ever. Ever. We go back to the Sahaba and those who followed them, that's it. We're never attached to a single person at any point in time. But this is the way of the deviant people. So Fir'aun was saying to the people, مَا أُرِيكُمْ إِلَّا مَا أَرَى. And this is the best thing for you. وَمَا أَهْدِيكُمْ إِلَّا سَبِيلَ الرَّشَادِ. And I guide you to nothing except the path of ultimate guidance. Rashad, يعني you're guided with intellect and understanding. The best policy in guidance. Fir'aun is telling the people that I am guiding you to that. وَأَضَلَّ فِرْعَوْنُ قَوْمَهُ وَمَا هَدَى. Allah says, and Fir'aun misled the people. He misled his people. Wallah, he didn't guide them anywhere except to Jahannam. He guided them only to the path of Jahannam. Jahannam, they will taste it, him and his followers. So we have to be careful of those who try to undermine the da'wah by using names and titles which Allah sent down no authority concerning. The Sufi, he will tell you, I'm a Sufi. Because Suf is this, and he will give you some interpretation. The Wahhabi will tell you, I don't know what you're talking about. Allah is the Wahhab. And if you mean Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, you know, his name is Muhammad. He was not Wahhab. He's not Wahib. For you say Wahhabi, where did you get that from? This title you created. And we say, look, if this is what you're going to give us as a name, and you're going to use it against us, that's your business with Allah. But at the end of the day, we follow that the teachings of that Shaykh and those who came before him, because they are the teachings of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you fall under the category of those, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا إِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. And verily, they will be among those, whenever it was said to them, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, they become arrogant. They don't like it. How can you say I cannot go to the grave of Fulan? And how can you say I cannot call on Fulan? How can you say I cannot do tawassul with Fulan? They don't like this. Keeping the Tawheed safe and safeguarded, they want shirk somewhere in there, so you become the enemy of Islam and they become the propagators of Islam. No, it doesn't work this way. This is a Firaunic mentality and methodology. Because that's what Firaun claimed. He was guiding the people to the best guidance, and Allah knows that he wasn't. Then the man continued. وَقَالَ الَّذِي آمَنْ يَا قَوْمِ إِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ مِثْلَ يَوْمِ الْأَحْزَابِ مثل دأب قوم نوح وعاد وثمود والذين من بعدهم وما الله يريد ظلما للعباد. Then he said, Oh my people, verily I fear for you an end like the disaster, like that day of the disaster of the confederates or the groups that came before, the old groups. Who are they? The people of Nuh and Ad and Thamud, and those who came after them. What happened to them? They rejected the messengers of Allah. Allah Azza wa Jal destroyed them. That is the manhaj that Allah Azza wa Jal deals with his disbelieving slaves. Now, after the advent of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he legislated, warfare and other things to deal with them. But back then, when the people would reject their messenger, it wasn't long before Allah Azza wa Jal will save the messenger and his followers, and he will destroy the nations. And they were destroyed. And Fir'aun wind up having a share of that. They didn't take his advice, and Allah destroyed him and his people like Allah destroyed the people of Nuh and Ad and Thamud. وَمَا اللَّهُ يُرِيدُ ظُلْمًا لِلْعِبَادِ. And Allah does not intend, He does not will any injustice for His slaves. Meaning Allah never punished them while they were innocent. He never punished them while they were ignorant. Allah only punished them after they were given a chance. They were given knowledge. The bayinat were brought to them, then they rejected them. Similarly, we Muslims, we fall under the same category. Once we know the truth, once we have learned the truth, once the bayinat have become clear to us, if we also deviate from that and we follow something else, then Allah may not exterminate us, but Allah will punish us as they were punished. There will be a punishment, and you have seen some in the Muslim world. Specifically in countries where adhering to the sunnah is not very common, and women don't wear proper hijab, and munkar is spread, alcohol is consumed. It's very common that these people are afflicted with natural disasters, which Allah sends. They come from Allah Azza wa Jal, not from anyone else, and Allah never oppressed us. He never dealt with us unjustly. We do this to ourselves. Then he said, continuing in the maw'idah, وَيَا قَوْمِ إِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ يَوْمَ التَّنَاتِ. And oh my people, verily I fear for you the day of mutual calling. Because there will be a lot of calling on that day. Allah Azza wa Jal, everyone will be called by his name. And he will have to stand before Allah and answer to the things that you have done in this life. Everyone will be called. The people of Jannah. وَنَادَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ. And the other, وَنَادَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ أَصْحَابَ الْجَنَّةِ. The people of Jannah will call the people of Nar, and the people of Nar will call the people of Jannah. In Surah As-Saffat, فَاطَّلَعَ فَرَآهُ فِي سَوَاءِ الْجَحِيمِ قَالَتَ اللَّهِ إِن كِتَّ لَتُرْدِينَ. Until, so there will be all this kind of calling going on between the people. And so it is called Yawm al-Tanad, which is the day of recompense or the day of resurrection. He said, I fear for you on that day. يوم تولون مدبرين ما لكم من الله من عاصم. On the day where you will turn your backs and you will flee. You will turn your backs and you will run away, and you will have no protector against Allah. This is a strong mawidah. لمن كان له قلب أو ألقى السمع وهو شهيد. For the one who has a heart, or he pays attention, he listens attentively and he's a witness, he witnesses what's happening, what's being said. Yani, be careful of that day. Be careful of that day of which is coming, ya akhwan. This day which we speak about now, you're sitting here in the auditorium, you got air conditioning, cameras, high-tech devices, you're wearing your nice clothes, and you're saying this is a long time from now. No, it is not. إِنَّهُمْ يَرَوْنَهُ بَعِيدًا وَنَرَوْهُ قَرِيبًا. You see it as something far, and Allah knows it's very near. The Prophet ﷺ said, بُعِثُ أَنَا وَالسَّاعَةَ كَأَتَيْنِ. I was sent forth along with the hour like this, meaning the time between the advent and the hour is not a long time. And for us, once we die, خلاص, it's not like you have to live until the day of recompense for you to believe in it, for you to see it. Once we die, we're there already. We are at the first stages of that. So he warned his people. But what is the bottom line? وَمَنْ يُضْلِلِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ هَادٍ. But whosoever Allah misleads, no one can guide. So we should rely on Allah for guidance. If you want Allah to guide you, then when you stand in the Salah and Fatiha, say, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. While we feel it, mean it, intend it. Sincerely. We sincerely ask Allah for hidayah, because without hidayah, we're nothing. And one of us feels special. You may start to feel special, I may start to feel special, mashallah, Muslim, alhamdulillah, miya miya, ya akhi. If Allah wants to change that overnight, who's going to protect you? And when we transgress, and we continue to follow our desires, then we will be deprived of that protection from Allah. This is why there's a jihad, now the jihad. This is jihad al-nafs, and jihad al-shaytan, until we meet Allah. Until you meet Allah, you have to struggle. إِنَّكَ كَادِحٌ إِلَى رَبِّكَ كَدْحًا فَمُلَاقِيهِ. There's a lot of struggle and effort that has to be done. Doesn't happen while you're lying down on your back, enjoying yourself. There's something that we have to put forth. Sometimes it is against ourselves, sometimes it is in service for others in Islam, but Islam has to be in the picture. Don't let Islam be going to the masjid on Jumu'ah,
after the imam is on the minbar, or even worse, after the imam began the salah, 80% of the people who came for Jumu'ah suddenly show up. Suddenly the masjid is full, people are praying on the street, people are praying behind the bathrooms, and the cars have blocked all the roads. Where were you, ya akhi? Where were you since 8 in the morning, 9 in the morning, ya kaslam? You lazy, lazy creature. How much do you sleep? Sleep, 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 all that sleep. After you eat, you sleep. Before you eat, you sleep. When you wake up, you sleep. And when you sleep, you sleep. Khalas. Everything sleep. Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah used to sleep 4 hours a day. 4 hours a day. 20 hours is up. Teaching, learning, giving fatawa, service in the Muslims. Now we're not that good, but come on now. 12, 14 hours of sleep every day. Go to Jumu'ah, you know, 12 o'clock, he's walking to the masjid, still, you know, rubbing his eyes. Ya akhi, why? Ya akhi, why? What do you have? What were you doing till Fajr? Qiyam? If it was Qiyam, it's haram. If you were doing Qiyam, if you were praying all night, and you're going to miss Fajr, or miss Jumu'ah for it, it's haram for you to do Qiyam. Because that is an obligation, that is a voluntary act. But the truth is, how many are doing Qiyam? They're doing Qiyam on something else. On the television set, or some video games, or some girgir all night, and then they come to Jumu'ah, you know, tired, lazy, half of the people showed up. What is this, ya akhwan? This is unacceptable. Allah, it's sad. It's funny, but it's sad. Yani, the worst affairs are those that are so bad that they make you laugh. This is the worst thing that can happen. Laziness in ways which we cannot even perceive. The ulama, some of them used to write at least like 30 pages each day. They would author 30 pages of ilm each day, akhwan. We can't even put a pamphlet together in 5 years. Why? Because we don't have this observation. We don't have this care, this determination to service the deen of Allah. We don't appreciate the deen of Allah enough. That's what it is. If you really love the fact that Allah made you Muslim, you will spend the night and the day trying to do something for the sake of Allah. Whether directly or indirectly. According to your ability. Because that's the least you can. And you will hope that Allah will protect you. Because Allah protects those who work for His deen. And we will see in the ayat which will come later. Those are those who Allah will give victory to. Allah will aid, Allah will protect. Those who are involved in da'wah, the scholars, the ulama, the people of enjoying the good and forbidden evil. The rest will be destroyed. The regular people will be destroyed. The one who only does righteous deed for himself, that's good for him, but that is not enough. Until you enjoin what is good and forbid what is evil, you have no protection from Allah in the ultimate sense. And you all know the hadith to that effect. That the one who was busy worshipping Allah and left the people upon munkar, Allah wasn't pleased with him. Allah musta'an. وَلَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ يُوسُفُ مِنْ قَبْلُ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ فَمَا زِلْتُمْ فِي شَكٍّ مِمَّا جَاءَكُمْ بِهِ حَتَّى إِذَا هَلَكَ قُلْتُمْ لَنْ يَبْعَثَ اللَّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ رَسُولًا كَذَلِكَ يُضِلُّ اللَّهُ مَنْ هُوَ مُشْرِفٌ مُرْتَابٌ. And verily, Yusuf, Joseph, had come to you before, in the older times, with the bayinat, with the clear proofs from Allah, and he's speaking to the people of Egypt. Before Musa, Allah sent Yusuf, and he was a messenger. But Allah Azza wa Jal gave him two qualities. He was given mulk, he was given a very high authority in the government, and he was a da'i. They say, the ulama in tafsir, the people of Egypt obeyed Yusuf concerning his rulership, but they didn't obey him concerning the da'wah to Islam. They were not obedient to him in terms of responding to the da'wah. They followed his commandments when he said, divide this and divide that as a ruler. But as da'wah, they were not very responsive to him. Subsequently, he said that to them, Yusuf had come to you before with the bayinat, and you remained in doubt concerning that which he brought to you. You were ever in doubt concerning that. Until when he died, you said, Allah will not send a messenger after him. Because of the state of doubt, and they disbelieve in the messenger, said, Allah will not send any messengers after him. After Yusuf alayhi salatu salam. Such Allah Azza wa Jal misguides the one who is transgressor and skeptic. We learn from this that when we transgress and we have doubt concerning the deen of Allah, then these are among the elements of deviance. This is where the dalal begins. When you second doubt the revelation which Allah sent down. And this is a very common feature amongst the Muslims today. That if they read an ayah which doesn't agree with what a scientific theory, which they say is a scientific fact, they second doubt the book of Allah and they believe, you know, Einstein. They doubt the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah وسلم, and the hadith of Bukhari, and they believe some other fulan, some historian. And this is the first, this is among the first steps which lead you to Jahannam. Because Allah Azza wa Jal, كَذَلِكَ يُضِلُّ اللَّهِ, such Allah will mislead the one who transgresses, the one who is skeptical, doubtful about the deen of Allah. You should have firm yaqeen that Islam is the only religion Allah will accept. إِنَّ الدِّينَ عَنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. In another ayah, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Don't be standing there saying Christians, believers, you know, the modernists. Christians are believers, Jews are believers, they're different kind of believers than we are, but they're believers. They're believers in what? They're kuffar, ya akhi. They are kuffar according to the explicit ayat in the book of Allah. If the Christian tell him, what is your religion based on? He would tell you either the Trinity or Jesus being the Son of God. And Allah says, لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثَ. They have disbelieved. He tell you, I'm a Unitarian Christian. I believe in one God. Say, okay. Then Allah Azza wa Jal said, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَيُرِيدُونَ أَن يُفَرِّقُوا بَيْنَ اللَّهِ وَرُسُلِهِ بَيْنَ اللَّهِ وَيَقُولُونَ نُؤْمِنُ بِبَعْضٍ وَنَكْفُرُ بِبَعْضٍ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ حَقًّا. Those who deny the Messenger of Allah, if he claims he's upon Tawheed, say, why don't you believe in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Because Allah says in the Quran, verily those who disbelieve in Allah and His messengers, and they want to make a separation, they want to make a distinction between Allah and His messengers. How? By saying, we will believe in some and disbelieve in some. وَيُرِيدُونَ أَن يَتَّخِذُوا بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ سَبِيلًا. And they want to take a path in between. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ حَقًّا. These are the disbelievers in truth. So there's no escape, akhi. You can be claiming at any point in time that any non-Muslim is a believer. The only believer among is the one who's a Muslim and he graduates to Iman. Any other religion, Allah will not accept. If they never receive the da'wah, we say their affair is to Allah. On Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah will deal with him. But in the dunya, he's not a Muslim, you treat him as such. So, skeptical, being skeptical, second doubting, you know, the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is something that is not acceptable in Islam. Now look at the ayah afterwards, which explains that. الَّذِينَ يُجَادِلُونَ فِي آيَاتِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ سُلْطَانٍ أَتَاهُمْ كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَعِنْدَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كَذَلِكَ يَطْبَعُ اللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ قَلْبِ مُتَكَبِّرٍ جَبَّارٍ. Those who dispute and argue concerning the signs and the ayat and the revelation of Allah, بِغَيْرِ سُلْطَانٍ أَتَاهُمْ, without any authority which Allah placed on them. Allah did not give them that authority, that position to be disputing, which is basically those who want to refute the truth with falsehood. Anyone who wants to refute the truth with falsehood, when you give him an ayah or a hadith, he rejects it with intellect, or with the sheikh said, or I read in a book, or my dad told me, then these are, according to the book, according to Allah, the kabura maqtan inda Allah. Allah hates greatly what they're doing, and those who believe. And believe me, those who believe, hate, you cannot believe the level of hate they have against someone who is presented with the truth, and he rejects it because of some other worldly reason. Some other invalid reason. Well, my dad or my parents, you know, told me otherwise. Back home, brother, this is how we have Islam. You know, this is your Islam. We practice that back home is a special way of Islam. In the West, you know, we have to have a special pledge. And they know, they said in the pledge that the Muslim scholars, they shouldn't get involved in it. You know, the ulama of the Arab and the others, that's none of your business, said, because in the West we have our own set of issues. And so what the ulama said, he said, say to them, the Islam which you have over there is the Islam we have over here. The deen of Allah is the same wherever you go. You cannot say, well, you keep mind your business, because you're trying to create a pledge which goes against the usul of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So they come up with these, you know, very strange things. And they argue and dispute in the ayat of Allah without any authority which Allah gave him, Allah hates it, and so do those who believe. So, either you have an evidence, or you don't have an evidence. And don't dispute and argue against the deen of Allah because of the way you feel. Like for example, just to give you a classical example, Jumu'ah Mubarak. I have mentioned in one of the lectures, someone asked, I think at the end of the lecture, about Jumu'ah Mubarak, and I explained that it is a bid'ah. Because the ulama have already said it's a bid'ah, and if you understand what bid'ah is in Islam, you will have no doubt that saying Jumu'ah Mubarak is a bid'ah. Because Jumu'ah is the day of Friday where the Jumu'ah is held, it's a blessed day in Islam, and Mubarak means blessed. It's a dua, meaning may Allah make your Friday blessed. It's a dua. They try to tell you that it's like good morning. Jumu'ah Mubarak is like good morning. Can you tell me that Jumu'ah Mubarak is like good morning? Yes, subhanAllah. You find, you know, and some of the brothers, may Allah reward them, they got this part of the lecture and they made it into a small video. And they put it on Facebook, different places. Ya akhi, wallahi, you read the comments of these people, wallahi, you won't believe. Everyone issues a fatwa. Everyone has something to say. Yeah, but I think, you know, Friday is such an important day that it should be okay to say Jum'ah Mubarak. What is this, ya akhi? What is this? I think, wallah, I believe. I think, you know, this, I think. What do you think? And you think this and you think that. This is the deen of Allah. Either you have an evidence for saying Jum'ah Mubarak, or you don't. And if you don't, it's a bid'ah. End of story. You're not better than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Cannot be. If he never said it, why are you saying it? You cannot be better than the Sahaba. If they never said it, why are you saying it? Are you going to tell me you managed to discover something in Islam which they all failed to discover? Ajib. It's impossible that anyone can be more guided than they were. So this is out of the picture. The people argue for the Jumu'ah Mubarak because they like it. They like it. So they yujadiruna fi ayatillah bighayri sultanin atahum. Allah didn't give them the authority. You're not qualified to be saying this is this or this is that. The ulama said it's a bid'ah. We convey the statement of the ulama. Who are you to refute that? Without an evidence because you feel and you like. Such Allah Azza wa Jal will seal the heart of every arrogant tyrant. And this is what it is. Once they become arrogant and they reject the truth, بَطَرُ الْحَقِّ وَغَمْتُ النَّاسِ, they reject the truth, they belittle the people, and the people bring the truth, Allah will seal their heart. And so you give them da'wah, but it will be of no avail. They will not understand, they will not be guided. They will not be guided afterwards. وَقَالَ فِرْعَوْنُ يَا هَامَانُ ابْنِ لِي صَرْحًا لَعَلِّي أَبْلُغُ الْأَسْبَابِ أَسْبَابَ السَّمَاوَاتِ فَأَطَّلِعَ إِلَىٰ إِلَهِ مُوسَى وَإِنِّي لَأَظُنُّهُ كَاذِبًا. Now listen to this. Fir'aun is still in the debate with this believing man. Fir'aun now is trying to mislead that he sees he's losing the battle, and this man is giving him these admonishments, and the people are, you know, maybe listening to this Rajul Mu'min, this Shama'an, if his name is Shama'an. So Fir'aun has to come up with one of his funny tricks now. He said, Haman, his minister, his wazir, construct for me a tower. A tower so I may ascend in the ways. The ways of the heaven so I may look at the God of Musa. And verily, I think he's a liar. So what is Fir'aun trying to do now? He's trying to trick the people by saying, look, you build a tower for me. I'm going to go up on this tower. I'm going to look over there. Say, I don't see any God. Come back down and say, Musa is a liar. What does that tell you? What does that tell you? What was Musa teaching? What was Musa teaching the people? That Allah is where? Allah is above. Yeah, Shaykh. That's why they say the ulama, look, is it possible that Fir'aun can have a better belief system than some of the Ash'aris today? And the Jahmis? Those who say Allah is everywhere? Fir'aun had a better belief system in this regard because he wanted to go up in the skies to look at Allah. Meaning Musa must have been teaching back then that Allah is above. Otherwise, Fir'aun would have said, let me go down, let me go around. He wouldn't want to go up. Going up indicates that he was taught that Allah is above. Mean that da'wah of Tawheed al-Aqidah, of Asma and Sifat, which we dealt in the lecture, do you really know him? Was being taught from way before. We did not bring it into existence. We are simply trying to follow it to the best of our ability. But anyways, Fir'aun tried to trick the people. Build for me a tower. وَأَنِّي لَأَظُنُّهُ كَذِبًا. But I think Moses is lying anyways. And then Allah said, وَكَذَلِكَ زُيِّنَ لِفِرْعَوْنَ سُوءُ عَمَلِهِ وَصُدَّ عَنِ السَّبِيلِ. Such, it was made beautiful for Fir'aun, the evil of his deeds. It was beautified for him. He couldn't see how blinded he was. وَصُدَّ عَنِ السَّبِيلِ. He was misled and he was hindered from the path. And he was hindered from the path. وَمَا كَيْدُ فِرْعَوْنَ إِلَّا فِي تَبَابٍ. And verily, the plot of Fir'aun is nothing but destruction and failure. He tried to plan and plot and go around the clock and do all this thing. Nothing happened. Allah Azza wa Jalla made all of his plan a failure. He was blinded. He couldn't see how misguided he was when he said he wants to ascend to look at Allah. What is the lesson which we learn? That you don't have to have tangible things to believe, ya akhwan. Iman is actually iman bi what? Bil ghayb. It's believing in the untangible, the unseen. Is it untangible or intangible? One of them. Ala kulli hal. It's believing in that which you cannot touch, that which you cannot smell, that which you cannot see. It's believing in malaika without seeing them. Believing in Allah without seeing Him. Believing in the messengers without seeing them. Believing in the day of judgment without seeing it. Believing in the punishment of the grave without seeing it. That's iman. Musa trying to be, you know, Fir'aun often trying to be funny. He wants to go up and see. If he doesn't see Allah, meaning Allah doesn't exist. لا تدرك الأبصار. No sight can over encompass Allah. No one can see Allah in this dunya. So Fir'aun is not going to be any special case. But if you enter Jannah, وَجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَى رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. Faces on that day will be glowing and illuminating, looking, gazing at its Lord. If you want to enjoy looking at Allah Azza wa Jal, it is not going to happen in this dunya. But if you go to Jannah, that's the mawid. That's the appointment. And that's the destination. But it doesn't happen again while we are sleeping for Salah and sleeping for Jumu'ah and barely practicing Islam. It happens for those who strive, those who make an effort, those who compete. إِنَّ هَذَا لَهُوَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ لِمِثْلِ هَذَا فَلْيَعْمَلِ الْعَامِلُونَ. This is the great success. For such, let those who strive and work, work. Not just for money, not just for business, that's going to go away. No matter how successful you become, it's going to go away. What will remain though, is what will help you make it to Jannah and see Allah Azza wa Jal. So I hope inshallah Allah will grant us success to make the right choices.
وَقَالَ الَّذِي آمَنَ يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُونِ أَهْدِكُمْ سَبِيلَ الرَّشَادِ.
Now he's refuting Fir'aun. This is the bravery which he wanted to speak about. خلاص. All barriers have been removed. Now Fir'aun told him earlier, مَا أُرِيكُمْ إِلَّا مَا أَرَى وَمَا أَهْدِيكُمْ إِلَّا سَبِيلَ الرَّشَادِ. Now the man said, قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُونَ. Oh my people, follow me. Follow me. أَهْدِكُمْ سَبِيلَ الرَّشَادِ. I will guide you to the path of guidance and correct guidance. So now he's telling him, forget about Fir'aun, follow me. Even though Fir'aun can kill him in no time. In no time, he can be killed. But Allah Azza wa Jal defends him. Allah supports him. Allah protects him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah will protect him, provided he's upon the truth. And even if he is afflicted with a calamity, even if he is in prison, even if something, Allah will protect him therein. Look at Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Prison for him was rahmah for the ummah. A man being imprisoned produced knowledge which perhaps he couldn't have done had he been, you know, let loose. Had he been alone without being imprisoned. Had he been free. But his imprisonment produced knowledge that the ulama continue to benefit from until today. Because of his imprisonment, all of those who were in prison were guided by Allah's leave after they were playing cards and wasting their time. Shaykh al-Islam turned the prison, rahimahullah, into a school, into a university of knowledge. So in the imprisonment of him, there's Allah's protection, Allah's guidance, and he loved it. And you all know the statement of Shaykh al-Islam saying, what are my enemies going to do to me? My garden is in my chest. He believed. And his iman, Ibn Qayyim said, you know, him and the other students, when we would get stressed out, mind you, they're free.
He said, when we would get stressed out, we would go to Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah in prison, and we will speak to him a little bit, and then we will regain our faith and our strength and go back out. The man in prison is giving him relief while they are free because of his iman. Allah will defend him. So don't think if something happens to a da'i, meaning Allah is not supporting him. No, no, no. The Prophet ﷺ was hurt during the wartime. He had to, you know, flee to another country, to another city, Afwan, from Mecca to Medina. He went through difficult times. He had to hide with Abu Bakr and Nighar. It doesn't mean that Allah doesn't defend. But what is the outcome? Who was the successful at the end? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subsequently, those of da'wah will be successful at the end. Ya qawmi innama hadhi al-hayatu al-dunya mata wa inna al-akhirata hiya daru al-qarar. Oh my people, verily this life of this world is nothing but enjoyment and entertainment, and the life to come is darul qarar, is the final abode, is the real home, the life to come. So again, he's why? Because people very often don't want to choose the truth because of the fun that they want to have in this dunya. Many people know that they need to return to Allah and repent, but they're given this choice: do I repent and obey Allah's commands, or do I enjoy this dunya? So they say, I like the dunya. I will enjoy the dunya, and they will abandon the rights of Allah. And this is why that you must be reminded, no, akhi, it's the other way around. This dunya is entertainment, but the life to come is where you really have fun. If you're really wise, I mean, let me give you an example. Maybe you like video games. You know these, you know, the video games arcade, right? If someone told you, look, I will let you go in there and play for 30 seconds, your favorite game, or you wait for 1 month, and I will give you the whole thing, you can play day and night, day and night, day and night. What would you choose if you were intellectual, if you were intelligent? Say, I'll wait for 1 month, man. What am I going to do with 30 seconds? As soon as you start the game over. What happened, man? Khalas. 30 seconds over, out. Hey, but, no, but, out. They will say you're dumb, because we gave you, said, wait 1 month, take it. There are thousands of games, play day and night 24/7, no worries. What is wrong with you choosing the 30 seconds, captain? So this is the idea. If you want to have fun, want women, wait. You want alcohol, wait. You want what? Food, wait. You want to sleep? Wait, you will never sleep again over there. There will be no need to sleep. But then is darul qarar. Now, mata. Yeah, you'll have a little fun. But that's it. What comes after is going to eliminate and erase all of this fun. The hadith says that the man yukhmas fi jahannam ghamsa. He will be dipped to jahannam once. The one who lived the most luxurious life, who had the Hummer and the Bentley and the castles, the nicest living fellow in the world, he will be dipped in Jahannam once. He will be asked, هَلْ رَأَيْتَ نَعِيمًا قَدْ. Have you ever enjoyed anything? Have you ever had any fun? He will say, Allah, nothing. Nothing. All of the fun he had in the dunya, maybe 60, 70 years, will be wiped out with one dip in Jahannam, let alone remaining there forever. That's the reality. But we need to understand. He said, من عمل سيئة فلا يجزى إلا مثلها ومن عمل صالحا وهو من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فأولئك يدخلون الجنة يرزقون فيها بغير حساب. Now this is aqidah of al-sunnah wal-jama'ah. Whosoever does an evil deed, he will only be requited with an equal one. And whosoever does righteousness, whether he is male or female, وهو مؤمن, while he's a believer. Meaning you have to be a believer, you can't be a kafir and do righteous deeds, and you cannot claim to be a believer without righteous deeds. You must have iman and amal salih. Otherwise they claim, like the murji'ah, that iman, the amal salih doesn't affect you. If you believe in the six pillars of iman, you go to Jannah. Say, no, it doesn't work this way. You have to back it up with amal salih. Those will enter Jannah, and they will be given, reward with no limit. They will be given, you know, blessings from Allah, bounties from Allah, بغير حساب, meaning without measure, without limit, without end, without accountability. No one say, we gave you such and such and such. It's going to be like this, forever and ever and ever and ever. And I can say forever, forever, as long as I'm alive. And it doesn't end. It doesn't end. This is what's waiting for us in Jannah.
Do you really want Jannah? Have you really striven to Jannah the way we should? Or are we just a bunch of, you know, funny people in this dunya just coming along and going by without anything being accomplished? Oh, I got a degree, oh, I'm a doctor, I'm an engineer, blah, blah, blah. And what have you done? Yeah, you became a doctor and you went and you traveled and you've done, and what? The whole, you know, our mind as Muslims is stuck on this secular education. Not trying to undermine it, but take it easy, ya jama'ah. If this is going to be the objective of life, wallahi, this is wrong. We better off remain ignorant if it's going to take us to Jannah rather than becoming educated and go to Jahannam. Because on the expense of education, people violate half of the deen of Allah. Half of the deen of Allah is went against riba and mixing and you name it. All of this is a byproduct of this knowledge. If you manage to do it, distance learning, you're able to keep you cool, keep the deen of Allah, give Allah's rights first, barakallahu fiqh. Alhamdulillah, we need you. But not the other way around. The other way around is no good. Then the man said amazing things. وَيَقُلْ مِي مَالِي أَدْعُوكُمْ إِلَى النَّجَاةِ وَتَدْعُونَنِي إِلَى النَّارِ. Oh my people, what is the matter with you? I call you to salvation and you call me to Jahannam. What is wrong with you? I'm telling you, come. And you know, every da'ya feels the same way. Every da'ya feels the same way. Like, what is wrong? Like every Friday my voice goes away on the minbar, begging myself and the Muslims to do something good. To come early. Every Friday I see them as I'm coming to the Jumu'ah to give the khutbah. I see them 1 minute before me. They see me, they run away. Wallahi, when they see me, they get afraid. Say, oof, I didn't know he was the khatib today. Ya Sheikh, why are you scared of me? What about Allah? I'm advising you to come early for what? For me? I need to show me that you're standing in the first row. Oh, okay, Abu Mus'ab is happy with me. Who cares what I think? You go for Allah. You go for the sake of Allah, whether I see you or I don't. Well, why did every da'ya feel this way? Ya Jama'ah, let us all work together, go to Jannah. Come on, let's get salvation. And it seems that some people just don't like it. They like it, but they don't like it. They listen, oh nice, yeah, me, okay. But where's the action, ya akhi? I'm not here putting on a show so you can like it and go home and, you know, stay up on the old ways. This is supposed to make a change in me and you. If you really benefit, then we need to act upon it. Otherwise, we're wasting each other's times, quite frankly. But I know, inshallah, you brothers, you know, doing hard work, and everybody's benefiting. بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ تَدْعُونَنِي لِأَكْفُرَ بِاللَّهِ وَأُشْرِكَ بِهِ مَا لَيْسَ لِي بِهِ عِلْمٍ. He's saying to the people, you call me to disbelieve in Allah and associate and partners with Him that which I have no knowledge of. وَأَنَا أَدْعُوكُمْ إِلَى الْعَزِيزِ الْغَفَّارِ. While I'm calling you to the one who is almighty and the most forgiving. Yani, what is this concept? What is this formula of yours? You want me to disbelieve in Allah and we go back to the Quburiyun, the grave worshippers, and the people of Tawheed. We go back to the people of Sunnah and people of Bid'ah. It's the same conflict, ya akhwan. It's the truth versus the falsehood. Here it is at a larger scale. With us it's on a lesser scale, but it exists. I'm calling you to a Tawheed and you're calling me to fulan and shirk and kufr and all this. Why? While I'm calling you to Allah Azza wa Jalla, the Aziz and Ghaffar. What is wrong with this da'wah? This is the correct da'wah. And this other da'wah is false. This is the concept. La jarama. And the ulama say it means no lie. Meaning, or truly. Anna ma tad'unani ilayhi laysa lahu da'watun fi dunya wala fi al-akhirah. Those who you are calling me to have no claim, have nothing. Not, they don't respond to anyone and they shouldn't be invited to, not in this dunya nor in the life to come. Wa anna maraddana ila Allah. And that our return is to Allah. Wa anna al-musrifina hum ashabun nar. And that the transgressors will be the dwellers of the hellfire. Now here's the title of the lecture. فَسَتَذْكُرُونَ مَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ. You will surely remember what I'm telling you. Ajib, this ayah, qasaman billah, you can read it over and over and over again, and just you can reflect on it until you can't reflect anymore. You shall, I wish I could see him. I wish I can imagine how he was. I can imagine his feelings while he's standing before this big crowd of kuffar. Amongst them is Fir'aun, saying to them, you will surely remember what I'm telling you. فستذكرون ما أقول لكم. But he didn't depend on himself. وأفوض أمري إلى الله, and I return my affair to Allah. Meaning Allah is the one who will guide my affair. Allah is the one who will protect me. And you will see. You will see what I have promised you. You will see what I have warned you. Hajib this ayah. You will surely remember what I am telling you. And every scholar and every da'iyah has this idea in the back of his mind. To himself and to others. Every time da'wah is given and people do not respond, the da'iyah feels in his heart, you will surely remember what I'm telling you. You think it's a joke now. You think leaving the sunnah is fine now. You think innovating into the deen of Allah is fine and it's something that is acceptable and entertained. But you will surely see and you will surely come to know what I'm telling you. When? When it will be of no benefit. When it will be too late. وَأُفَوِّدُ أَمْرِي إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. Verily Allah is ever watchful over the slaves. He knows the affairs of the one inviting and the one being invited, the one calling to the truth and the one calling to falsehood. Allah sees everything, knows everything. You can play games, you can hide, you can disguise, you can trick the masses and the Muslims, but you cannot do it for long. Allah knows about your affairs. And so I say this to everyone who is calling to anything but the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I say this to everyone who calls to a group, whether it is Jama'at Tabligh or Ikhwan al-Muslimin or the Salafis or anyone who has made a group and calling the people to it, dividing the Muslims thereof and causing division among them without any just cause. I will say to them the same thing. You will surely come to see what I'm telling you. You will remember what I'm telling you because Allah did not allow this. Allah did not allow this division of the Ummah. Allah commanded us to hold on to the rope of Allah altogether. Not by agreeing with falsehood ever. But we remain firm upon the truth. We call people to the truth. And we try to merge them into the truth. We don't merge the truth with the falsehood. But we don't divide the ummah either. This is the call that we have to be firm upon. Otherwise, too much division, too much talk, too much backbiting, too much nonsense for no good reason. Yes, there are the people of sunnah and the people of bid'ah. But among the people of sunnah, there should be no division. There should be harmony, love, collaboration, understanding, so that we can bring the people of bid'ah to the sunnah. It is not that you want them to be destroyed, it is that you want them to be guided like Allah guided you, because you will not believe until you want for your brother what you love for yourself. This is the mentality. And Allah sees the affairs of the slaves, and Allah will hold us accountable to that. What happened? Look at the final summary that Allah gave us in the last ayah. فَوَقَاهُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِ مَا مَكَرُوا وَحَاقَ بِآلِ فِرْعَوْنَ سُوءُ الْعَذَابِ. So Allah protected him from the evil torment. Allah protected him from the plot which they had plotted against him. And then the evil torment encompassed Fir'aun and his people. Allah protected him. فَوَقَاهُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِ مَا مَكَرُوا. Allah protected him. This was the bottom line. If you remain upon the truth and you call to the truth, Allah shall protect you. Just like Allah protected this da'i who stood before the masses and proclaimed the truth, and he was brave in doing so. He didn't sugarcoat, didn't change, didn't try to please them. He told it to them in their face, just like it is, and ended it with saying, and you will surely remember what I'm telling you. This is the epitome of power in speech. And Allah Azza wa Jal protected them accordingly. You go back a few ayat till ayah 52. Allah Azza wa Jal says, and I want to share this ayah with you. إِنَّا لَنَنْصُرُ رُسُولُنَا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْأَشْهَادِ. What is the conclusion of that? Allah says, verily, no doubt, surely, we will make victorious our messengers and those who believe. When? فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, in this worldly life. وَيَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْأَشْهَادِ, and on the day when the witnesses will stand. So after the summary of the story, Allah told us, what is the bottom line? We will surely make victorious the messengers and those who believe in this dunya. So, what is the objective now? The objective, ya akhwan, is that we learn the deen of Allah as it is. And we convey the deen of Allah as it is. We have boundaries in terms of what is acceptable from among the deviant people and what is not. We deal with them according to the wisdom and according to the condition of the Ummah today, where the people of the Sunnah are a minority and the people of innovation are a majority. So we have to have a strategy in the way we deal with things. But we don't have a pledge where we destroy foundations that our righteous predecessors built. We don't have a pledge which will entail melting the truth with the falsehood so that the truth will no longer be understood by the people. If you let every Tom, Dick and Harry come speak about Islam, and he is upon major deviance, not someone with errors, he is misguided people, and you remain silent, wallahi, you are betraying the Muslims. You're betraying them. We must make this evident. And if you promise someone who like these people that they promised, I'm not going to mention names, I'm going to avoid mentioning names. If you promise these people that you won't say anything about them, wallahi, this is a betrayal to the deen of Allah. You were supposed to remain upon the truth. You want to give him da'wah, jazakallahu khayran. No one is going to stop you. They invite you to give a lecture in the masjid, go. Don't say, oh, this is a masjid of people of innovation, I'm not going to go. How are they going to be guided to the sunnah if you don't go? If they give you the platform, go. Give them da'wah. If they believe it, alhamdulillah, they don't. It's none of your business. You're not living with them, mixing with them, loving them. But you're wise. If anyone gives you a platform to give the sunnah, any way you give me, we should go. That's one approach. The other approach is, everything goes. Oh, I'm not going to say anything. No, Habibi. So we have to be very balanced in our approach, in the way we give da'wah. Surah Allah Azza wa Jal will protect the ummah and will produce with the promise which we were given will materialize. How? When we follow this strategy and this methodology and we stick to the deen of Allah without making any changes or alterations to it. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Ouch. Any questions? It's a long lecture, I apologize. No. Sorry. Any questions pertaining to the subject? Jazakallah khair. Now. Surah Al-Ghafir. You came late?
Yes, I did.
You usually come early. I see you in the front. Alhamdulillah. Anything else, guys? It's late. It's almost 10 to 11. I'm sure you'd like to go home and get some rest. So if there are no questions, we can call it a day, inshallah. Right. So like I said, bi-ithnillah azza wa jal, if all goes well, there will be lectures in Ramadan. You will be notified via SMS as usual. Subhanakallah wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.